This cassette is a recording of an interview which explains many of the ideas and concepts of Dr. Glenn Swarthout's Five Phases of Health, a model of the progressive stages of degeneration or regeneration of health. Dr. Swarthout is a magna cum laude graduate of Dartmouth College and earned his doctorate in vision science at the State University of New York with numerous honors. He has written several books, including Electromagnetic Pollution Solutions, and has been named Man of the Year by the American Biographical Institute. Dr. Swarthout practices in Hilo, Hawaii, and lectures all across Hawaii and North America. Interviewing Dr. Swarthout will be Kay Snow Davis, international author, educator, and lecturer. She has been involved for over 27 years in the field of human resource development. Ms. Snow Davis is the author of the book, Point of Power, A Relationship with Your Soul. She resides in Maui, Hawaii, where this interview was recorded.
Hello, Dr. Glenn. It's wonderful to be here with you again today. And I'd like you to give us some information about what you're involved in life and what keeps you busy as Dr. and as Glenn.
Okay, thanks, Kay. Well, very much involved with the Remission Foundation in Hilo, Hawaii, where we do research on health and how the body can restore its health, even when we're coming from a place of chronic or degenerative disease. There are decades of research in natural medicine from Europe that actually show and document how the body can transform a disease state back to health through natural methods and natural support. That's what I'd like to introduce people to today, what we call the five phases of health, of rebuilding, regaining, rebalancing our health. And it's really founded on looking at the energetics of health, even beyond the structure of the body, beyond the chemistry of the blood or of physiology, but looking at the energetics behind that. When people talk about energy, often the response is, well, what do you mean by that? What is energy? And there are many different definitions. So I want people to understand that we're talking about the physics of energy, the actual scientific definitions of energy. And so there are ways to literally measure this in the body and to observe the patterns of energy and how they shift from a state of imbalance in the energy, which we call disease, to a state of balance, which we call the healing process, where the body can then change over time chemically toward a balanced state of body chemistry and even restructure itself back to a normal physical structural state. Literally, we're repairing and rebuilding our tissues, our cells, our organs every day that we're alive. That's part of the life process. Without that, we'd all be dead in very short order. Our blood has to rebuild itself every few months. Our immune system is regenerating itself, the active parts of it, every few days. And while there are tissues like the nerve cells, that where a single cell will last our whole life, and so we want to certainly support that, maintain the health of those areas that can't regenerate, most of our cells do regenerate. That means if a cell dies, another one can take its place, and we can repair that tissue. So let's start at what we call phase one, which is the beginning point, if we're already out of balance. And literally, if we look at the American population today, most of us, by the time we're adults, are, by definition of the energy state, we are in that phase one terrain or condition that is the energetic state from which chronic degenerative disease springs. Now, we may not have an identifiable disease state at that point in time, and yet we may have the energetic pattern that is producing that in the process of creating a disease that might be identified 10 or 20 years down the line.
So phase one is part of a five-phase plan that you have found to be very beneficial in identifying and supporting a way to regenerate health and to
exactly
know at what level and what items, herbs, whatever are useful for that. So phase one is what part of this then?
Phase one we call energize, because that's the goal in phase one is to re-energize the cell metabolism.
Mm-hmm.
It's when the cell energy is low, somewhere below, especially if it's below, say, 20% of what it should be, where the cell is not able to repair the damage that's done to each cell on a daily basis. We know that An average cell is going to be exposed to 10,000 free radical attacks every day. And so, yes, we can take antioxidants to help defend ourselves against those attacks, or even antioxidant water technology, which we'll talk about later on the other side of this tape. But beyond that, we need to re-energize the cell so it has the energy to, specifically to detoxify itself, because it's toxins that produce those free radicals. The more we can detoxify the cells, the fewer free radicals there are. And so the more our antioxidants will be able to maintain their potency and keep the cell in a good state of repair, and to repair the cell, to repair the damage when it is done. So it's tipping those scales. You know, our body, it's amazing. If we think about the kinds of things we're exposed to today, with literally hundreds of thousands, maybe millions of new chemicals that are toxic to our body that we're exposed to in the air, the water, our food, in the environment today. We need nutrients, vitamin C, other antioxidants and different nutrients, minerals to defend ourselves against those. We use them up in the process of defending ourselves against these new attacks, things like electromagnetic pollution, which I wrote a book called Electromagnetic Pollution Solutions that really educates people about that, because it's something that, while they've heard about it more in Europe, people here are just beginning to understand that, yeah, the energy of our environment affects our body and our health. And it's very strongly linked to this low energy terrain, along with other energy depleting types of stresses, things like antibiotics, which, again, people don't realize that they're getting antibiotics when they eat commercial meats. Especially the pork industry, there's more antibiotics fed to the pigs to fatten them up, to actually cause a disease called leaky gut syndrome, so that they'll put on more weight, which is toxic weight, toxic tissue. We're going to rebuild our body out of that. Now, if we put in toxins and we're rebuilding out of that, we're building toxic cells in our own body. Or vaccinations have been shown in the actual energy measurements of the body. So this is not a theory now. It's an actual scientific observation that vaccination of children puts the body into a low energy state, which, again, we've observed in the research from European biological medicine that is the precursor state for chronic degenerative disease. So we're setting ourselves up for adult cancer when we have childhood vaccination, mm-hmm. or even the typical series of childhood allergy shots. By the time it's effective, quote unquote, effective medically to remove the allergy symptoms, the reason is that it's depleted the energy that the body has to produce those symptoms. And that, so if we start re-looking at symptoms as rather than the problem, but as a symptom of something that's causing that problem, because the symptom, like an allergy, is the body's reaction to something. What is it reacting to? Why is it reacting in that way? And if we can remove the cause, if we can identify that, if we can support the body to complete the reaction in many cases, because the purpose of a reaction like a headache is to dissolve some toxic material that's in the head, in the tissues in that area, in order to eliminate it. So rather than taking an aspirin that will suppress and put the body into a lowered energy state, and if it has the energy to come back the next day and try to redissolve that toxin along with the aspirin, that get a headache again. The medical research shows if you have a headache and you take an aspirin, you're more likely to get another headache the next day. And this is the reason. Now we can begin to understand all these seemingly disconnected observations that don't make sense in a conventional medical sense. It's just side effects.
So what is the key ingredient in phase one then that needs to be replenished for the cells to begin to have energy again?
Well, the key here is inside the cell in something called the mitochondria. It's kind of like a little bacterium that lives symbiotically with our own cells. It has literally its own DNA, its own genetics. And so it's like another life form that produces 90% of the energy of our cells in their normal healthy state. It's where we have the aerobic metabolism. It's where we have oxygen-based metabolism. Mm-hmm. And we know, for example, that a cancer cell only produces about 10% of the normal energy level, and it does not use oxygen. Mm-hmm. And if we can supply enough oxygen to that cell, and we have now energetic solutions that will stimulate the circulation to bring that oxygen to the cell totally naturally, then that cell can actually revert back to a healthy cell. And we've known that for longer than we've had a war on cancer in this country, using only toxic and invasive methods, where here's a non-toxic, non-invasive method to give the cell what it needs to actually take that, what I look at a cancer cell as a toxic waste dump in the body. Mm-hmm. It's not a cell that's attacking us at all. Mm-hmm. It's literally prolonging our life. And meta-analysis of all the cancer research done in Europe, the analysis done in Europe recently, they found that actually people who don't go through radiation, chemotherapy, or surgery live longer. And we know the quality of life is better with many of those treatments if you avoid them. So the body is prolonging its life the best it can with the tools it has. But what it needs to reverse that and clean up that toxic waste dump, to literally dissolve and break down those toxins, is oxygen, number one. We know we can't live very long without oxygen. We know we need that in the cell to produce 90% of the energy potential of the cell. So oxygen is number one. Now we also need, we need vitamins. For example, the B vitamins, very, very critical in energy production in the cell, because they are what we call the coenzymes for the electron transport chain. So now we're already talking about energy. Electrons, electrical energy that's released from our food is what gives us that 90% of the energy. It's an electromagnetic energy, and it's literally a photon or light energy carried by those electrons. If we think about it, you know, just logically, we all know and can logic out the fact that life energy comes from sunlight. Except for there's a couple of species of bacteria that we know about that live around volcanoes, either under the ocean or around fumaroles, these warm pools around volcanoes, and those live on sulfur energy from the earth. But everything else, 99.999% of life on earth comes from sunlight energy that's absorbed in the cells of plants through photosynthesis. That energy is captured in a carbon-carbon bond. Okay, so you have these photons from the sun stored for however long, they can be stored for centuries, literally, in that carbon-carbon bond. If we have a piece of coal, let's say, that coal still, well, actually, the coal has probably been broken down to just elemental carbon, so the bonds have lost its energy at that point. But certainly, we could have a 100-year-old egg, maybe, in the Chinese cuisine, and what's left of the energy there is light energy from the sun. We can literally measure that with things like Curlian photography. Many people have probably can recall seeing a photograph of this beautiful energy aura or field around a leaf of a plant or around someone's fingertip. And that's the light or photon energy field around living matter. As that matter dies, as that leaf dies over a period, the cells die over a period of several hours, and you take successive photographs, you'll see that energy field shrink. You'll see areas start to turn black where there is no life energy anymore. And we can see this on Curlian photographs of people's fingers. And it's been actually mapped out, just like we have maps of the body in the brain or on the iris of the eye in iridology, or on the ear in acupuncture, or on the hands and feet in reflexology, how the body is a map upon itself many times over, and literally every cell in your body has a map for the whole body in the DNA, right? We know that our body is produced from a single cell. Well, this energy field then can show us the patterns of imbalance in the energy in the body through Curlian photography. This is just one method. There are many other methods, such as the German techniques of electroacupuncture, a school called electroacupuncture according to Vohl, or EAV, many people have heard about. Another one is the Vega test method, and there are others. Other methods that were independently developed in Japan and other parts of the world to measure and observe the body's energy system on a modern scientific basis that confirms things like classical acupuncture, diagnosis through the pulse. In fact, there's even technology to measure the changes in the pulse that can tell you what part of the body is stressed. So science is finally coming up to a level where it's sensitive enough to be able to measure the electromagnetic energy of the body and be able to detect the energy imbalances, whether it be from studies of heart rate. Again, you can see the patterns in the heart rate variability. There's many different ways to tap into it. The key is that we now have these ways to tap into the body's energy system. It's like wiretapping into the body's own internal communication system of how it coordinates and sends signals from one area of the body to another to deal with these energy imbalances. Like if you have a shortage of energy, let's say in the liver, and so now your liver energy is too low and you can't break down the toxins coming in the bloodstream from your digestive tract, from maybe maldigestion, well, those toxins are going to build up, and that's going to affect other parts of the body, and other areas will have to compensate for that. You're going to have to change your circulation patterns. Maybe you won't send as much blood to the brain because now the blood is toxic, because you're trying to protect the brain and keep it working for more years. So the body is an incredible, incredible system to maintain life under stress, under a variety of different stresses. And so when one system goes down, we often will have backup systems. The kidneys will work extra hard in this case where the liver function is down.
So it really seems to be well documented that with what you're working with, phase one is the energy base of the cell itself in order to have strong systems, in order to have a strong and healthy body. And what are the clues then that you look for in phase two?
Well, this is very interesting because in the medical and scientific research, there's over 3,000 cases documented of cancer going through a process called spontaneous remission. Now, why we don't have billions of dollars of research going into studying that, I believe is because nobody's going to be able to patent it, because it's only through natural means that we can support and stimulate the body to go through that kind of a healing, self-healing process. But in every case of spontaneous remission from cancer, and we're talking about fully documented cancer, could be metastasized, could even be in many different tissues throughout the body, terminal cases, in 24 to 48 hours, that cancer can be gone from every part of the body. 1 to 2 days, it's gone. But in every case, it's associated with bacterial activity in the body, what we would call bacterial infection. We'd consider that another disease. Medicine would treat it with an antibiotic, would suppress that disease as we look at it from natural medicine perspective, and that could suppress the healing process. In every case, it's associated with a fever, which is not caused by the bacteria, but is a response to the bacteria, response by the immune system, and tells us that there's enough energy in the system already to make that response. So it's interesting, which came first, the bacteria, which is in the body all the time, or the energy level comes up to a level where the bacteria has something to terrain that it can thrive in, which is this phase two terrain, has a higher energy level required for bacterial growth, and also at the same time for our own cells, including immune cells, that they have a high enough energy to produce a fever response. Now, hyperthermia is one treatment for cancer and other certain other diseases. So the body's able to produce that on its own. We know people, the Japanese, using the furo, or the Scandinavians with the sauna. That's one way to help maintain a clean and healthy body. And so they have lower rates of things like cancer in those areas.
I think so it really sounds like we have some missing information.
Absolutely.
On the body's natural, healthy response to healing itself, to maintaining health. And so we're misreading symptoms, and then we're mistreating these symptoms in direct contradiction to what the body really wants to do to help us be well.
That's right. In other words, if you haven't had a fever in a few years or 10 or 20 years, that's a precursor to cancer. Even a common cold once a year is a perfect prevention and maybe even cure for the beginning states of cancer. We're all forming cancer cells every day of our life, but our immune system has the energy to go in there and clean that up, to provide the oxygen to dissolve the toxins or to break down that cell and so the body can regenerate a new cell. It's when the energy is low and we can't clean it up and we don't have, you know, a couple of colds or fevers a year. Now, it's not to say, you know, our body should be able to clean that up in a few days and get over the fever. And, you know, if it can clean up cancer in 2 days, mm-hmm. well, okay, that's, we know that if we have a fever, we should be able to get over it in a couple of days. It shouldn't hang on for months. That shows that we're on the edge mm-hmm. of a low energy state, like a chronic viral type of condition, and things like chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia, things like this that are chronic low energy states, but with, you know, tendency toward low fevers and things like that, recurrent fevers. It says we're on the edge of that low energy state.